Psalms 1. I started out 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, because I wanted to encourage you all as we leave 2018. I wanted to leave with you some encouragement from God as to the work that we have done and how we have began to transfigure to what God would have us to be. Everybody has it? Amen. Let's read. It says here, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners. I'm just going to talk a little bit louder. Nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. Listen, it says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law do he meditate day and night. He shall be
like a tree
planted by the rivers of waters that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The ungodly, it says in 4, are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind driveth away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knoweth the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Let's bow. Father God, we come now in the master's name of Jesus. Lord, first of all, we just want to declare that we love you, Lord. We love you with all of our heart, with all of our mind, and with all of our soul. We thank you for bringing us back out into thy house one more time
to hear of your word,
to eat of thy word that makes us better for nutrition and for our souls. Father God, we thank you that you have allowed our days to roll on a little while longer, and you designed it even before we was in our mother's womb that we would be here on today. So Father God, whatever your purpose is for us to be here today, God, we ask that you use us until you use us up. Father God, you said, if you told Joshua that if we would assemble ourselves together, Father God, with our mind and our heart on you, that not only would you be in the midst, oh God, but you said that you would feed us with manna from on high, God.
Yes,
and so
yes,
now,
yes,
Father
yes.
God, we come with our hearts and minds lifted up unto you, God. Our cups are empty and ready to be filled. So, Father God, we ask you to feed our hungry souls with the bread of life, Lord. Lord, we know that your word is still in effect because you said in Matthew's that before one jot or tittle of your word shall fail, heaven and earth shall pass away, and we're still on earth, Father God. It's still spinning and it's still rotating. So we know that what you said back then still works for today. Lord, we thank you and
thank
we give you.
You
glory for all
thank
things.
You.
In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated in the presence of God. Amen. Amen. And I want to leave out of 2018 giving praise, and not only giving praise to God, but giving encouragement to you. Amen. It's interesting that when I thought about encouragement and encouraging, I wanted to make sure I had the definition of encouragement on my mind. I said, Lord, okay, give me the definition that makes sense and encouragement. And here's what Webster declares. He says that the action of, you may be seated in the presence of God, but the action of giving someone support, confidence, and hope. Amen. Something like saying to you guys, like I just did, thank you for what you've done this year. Thank you for how you participated and you made this walk with God so much better because of you all. That's encouragement. That's letting you know that I appreciate what you all have done this year. When I said at the anniversary, thank you all for what you've done. You know, people look at small congregations and think that there's no might that come out of congregations because they're small. But what you guys show is not only is there might, but there's substance to what you do because you do it in the name of God and you do it from a heart that is blessed by God. That's what I talk about when I'm talking about encouragement. Encouragement is like hastening. It's like cheering up. It's like inspiring. It's like motivating. It's like stimulating. It's like fortifying. Amen. It's a persuasion to do or to continue something. It's like incentives and encouragement when somebody plays sports. You know, they when they play sports, they persuade them to do the best they can. Why? Because it makes them feel good. It makes somebody feel good to know that you got a cheering section behind you with whatever you do. It says the act of trying to stimulate the development of an activity, a state, or a belief. The encouragement of anything causes people to feel better about what they're doing. You know how it is when you do something and you put your heart into it. And at the end of it, nobody seems to notice what you're trying to do. Nobody seems to understand that all you're trying to do is the best that you can do. But when somebody says to you, look, I see what you're doing, and I see how you're doing it, and you're blessing somebody, or I see what you're doing, and I like what you're doing, it gives you the motivation to want to do more So as we go out, I wanted to encourage you all. Last time I talked about the three things that you needed, amen, in terms of being blessed. And now I want to talk to you today about how to stay blessed. How do I get to a place where God is blessing me and I stay there? Think about it. I can give you, if you're hungry, I can give you a fish and you can eat for one day. But if I teach you how to fish, y'all know that old proverb. But if I teach you how to fish, you can eat for a lifetime. Amen. Amen. And so, my brothers and sisters, as I looked at encouraging you all and seeing how you've been blessed by God, I want to show you how to stay blessed. Amen.
Come on, Bridget.
I want to show you how to stay in the safety nest of God. I want to show you how to be in favor with God at all times. I've only got three things to show you or to tell you out of this text, and I promise you, I will be out of the way. Amen. The background for this text comes from Psalms, and I'm becoming a firm lover of Psalms. Psalms is supposed to be songs of praise, songs of worship, songs of glory and glorifying God. We now have here before us one of the choicest and the most excellent parts of the Old Testament, my brothers and sisters. So much is in there about Christ and his gospel, as well as of God and his law. Are you hearing me?
All right, preacher.
That it has been called the abstract or summary of both the New Testament and the history of Israel and the Old Testament, amen, which was long upon, it allowed us to camp in places of Old Testament, it allowed us to camp in places of history, and it also allowed us to camp in places for where Jesus Christ not only was coming, but where he was going.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? It allowed us to be a part of councils, it allowed us to be a part of boards, and there entertain the instructs. It instructs us basically of the knowledge of our God. Amen. The book of Job brought us into the schools and treated us with profitable dispensations concerning God and his providence. But this book here This book of Psalms brings us into the sanctuary of God. We're no longer porch dwellers as we began to look at Psalms. We're now in the sanctuary of God. Amen. And in the sanctuary of God, it draws us out from a conversation or a conversion with men, with politicians, with philosophers. The book of Psalms, my brothers and sisters, directs us into the communion with God by reposing our souls in Him and lifting up and letting our hearts toward Him be fed and filled by God. Thus may we be in the mount with God and be in direct communion with God when you start dealing with the Psalms. I told you before there's ever praise of God, there's worship of God. In fact, our praise comes out of our worship. And Psalms were songs that were sung after God had worshiped with them or done something great for them.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? That's why when you went home and you began to think of the goodness of Jesus, of the goodness of God, when you began to worship Him in what He's done, a praise ought to come out of your mouth. When you start singing those songs of old and you get to singing and tapping your foot, all of a sudden you begin to worship God, and as you worship God, your feet get lighter, your hands get clappier, and all of a sudden you find yourself wrapped up in what you are doing, and all you are doing is praising God for what He's already done. Have I got a witness? You're telling God, look here, I recognize what you've done, and I recognize why you've done things, and now, God, I got to give you some praise. I got to say thank you somewhere in what you've done, because I now realize if it was not for Jesus, that things wouldn't be the way they are. And you got to step in. When you stepped in, things would not have been the way. I wouldn't be smiling right now, oh God, if I was sitting here and you had not done what you've done. That's what Psalms does for us. Psalms takes us to a place in God that we don't even imagine or recognize we're there until after the song is over. Amen. You got some of those, I know if you think back, you got some of those songs, old songs in your mind, and every time you hear them, you think about that girl or that boy, you think about that party or that dance. You didn't think about it when y'all was courting each other. You didn't think about it when you was doing what you was doing, but now, every time the song comes up, something draws you back to that day when that happened, and when that's why, that's how songs is. Psalms remind you that God is a good God, and you don't have to add, yes, He is, because Psalms takes you to the point where you say, look here, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. Psalms take you to that place. It brings you back into direct communion with God. Amen. And so today, as we began to look at this thing, and we began to look at this Psalms, let me give you just a little bit of review point, just in case you missed something last night. Last week, there were three things that we got from last week, Romans 12 and 2. And the first thing was, is we needed to know what was good and what was bad. Amen. We had to understand what was good and what was bad to be able to know or to be able to disseminate what's good before us and what's bad before us in order to please God. Have I got a witness? The second thing is we needed to know what was acceptable to God from our lives. There's some stuff even in us now that is really not acceptable to God. Amen? That's why the Bible says all of us have sinned, and here's the catch that we miss, and fallen short. Falling short means that we still have not hit the mark. But guess what? Every day He wake me up, I'm trying to get to the mark. Every day He brought me back into a conscious world, I'm trying to get to the mark. Why? Because He's been just that good to me. But I got to know what is acceptable to God, so that as I began to look at my life and began to get more like God, I can concentrate on getting rid of the things that are not like Him. The second thing, or the third thing, and I'm gonna get away from this, is we needed to know what was the perfect will of God for our life. The perfect will of God. Jeremiah said, look, he said, I got some plans for you. He had plans for us before we even entered into our mother's womb. He had plans already drawn up. Our life was already in the mind of God, exactly what we were going to be and exactly what our struggles was going to be, exactly what our issues was going to be. It was already in the mind of God. And Andre, before you ever got in Miss Pointer's womb, it was in his mind already set up what day you were going to come back to him. It was set up in his mind when you was going to have a disaster or a situation to come up. Why? Because everything that happened to you, it was to turn you back toward him and to make 180 degrees. Yeah, yeah, we need to know, even now, being saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost, what is the will of God for the rest of my life? That's why it says, look here, teach me the number of my days so that I might apply my heart toward wisdom. But what is the wisdom that you need to apply your heart to? The wisdom you need to apply your heart to is what the perfect will of God is for your life. Sometimes we can serve God and be so out of sync with where we should be, because God wants us to be over here, but we over here because we think that's what God wants. But when every time you get down and pray, you want to ask God, what's your will for my life?
What is it, Lord?
What is it that I need to be doing? Amen. What is the perfect will? And when you know this, you set the stage for being blessed because of the renewing of your mind. It's being transformed by the renewing of your mind. And as you renew your mind with the word of God, guess what? God will begin to lay out to you what the plan is, or what the will is, or for what he wants you to do with the rest of your life. Have I got a witness?
Amen.
Are you following me so far?
Amen. Yeah.
Okay. Now that we've gotten that far, amen, the transformation is being interpreted as being blessed. It's about being blessed and staying blessed. Amen. The first thing in that first verse says, blessed is, amen. And I needed to stop there because I want to make sure we understand what it is. He said, listen, blessed is, that means happy is the man. Amen. That means happy is he. Amen. Blessed is happy is he, that he, one, lives godly. Amen. And two, to put his trust in God. Three, to have his sins forgiven. I don't know about you, but every time I think about the fact that God forgives all of my sins, not only what I've done, but the things that I haven't even done yet. Guess what? There's a blessed in there. There's a happy is he in there. When God is fellowshipping with you, there's a blessed in there. There's a happy is he in there. So blessed is, amen, where I draw my strength from, and my strength is drawn from God. Psalms 84 and 5 says, and know how to worship God. So I'm blessed when I know how to worship God, amen. I'm blessed when I'm chasing, or when God corrects me for the things that I do against God, amen. Because you don't understand, even though God might forgive you for what you do, guess what? My grandmother said, and she wasn't a biblical scholar, but she said, look, baby, you may not pay for everything you do before you go, but guess what? You're going to reap what you sow. Amen. I thank you for helping me with that thing. That's how you stay blessed, when you can deal with God and be chastened by God and still not walking around pouting about what God. God will take you through some things in order to get some stuff out of you. Amen. In order to correct you, in order to bring you to the fold. Sometimes God will lead you around the backside of a mountain when you could have went straight over. Why? Because sometimes he got to teach you some stuff about you that you never even knew was there. Amen. So being chastened by God is all right. Blessed is the man who also fears God. And when I say fear God, I'm not talking about being scared of him, but fearing the fact that God is sovereign and he can do whatever he wants to do. God has all power. God has all strength. And whatever God wants to do, you got to recognize who he is in your life and how he works in your life and how he benefits you for being in his life. Blessed is, or happy is, the man who lives an undefiled life. Amen. A man who obeys the word of God. Amen. A lot of times in our lives, we miss out because we refuse to obey the word of God. Or sometimes we don't even realize that we're disobeying the word of God. Amen. But here's the other thing, and I'm gonna get out with this. Blessed is he, or happy is he who walks in wisdom and can hear the wisdom of God. My God, my God, my God, when you can walk in the wisdom of God, when you can have his word down on the inside, it'll stop you from sinning against him. In fact, Psalms 119, verse 11, that's the first verse I ever learned of the Bible. It says, for thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against you. So anytime you can hear God in wisdom, amen, and God is walking with you in wisdom, amen, there's something about having the word of God. Because see, that's like a reservoir that it springs up in you. And anytime you need to use the word of God, it is right there. When you're walking with God, guess what? It says he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me that I'm his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there is like none, nobody has ever known. Amen. There's a difference between being blessed and having mercy. I'm going to explain this, and then I'm going to move forward. See, most people in this world, most saved or unsaved, has mercy. Everybody enjoys the mercy of God. Bible says in Matthew 5:45 that you may be the children of your Father which is in heaven, for he maketh the sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and sendeth the rain on the just and on the unjust. So God gives us mercy, amen, because mercy keeps us from getting what we deserve. If he came in here right now, you and I would deserve 1,000 hells. But God, Jesus, is standing there saying, wait a minute, God, we're not going to give them what they deserve. We're not going to take them. My blood keeps them from getting what they deserve. But see, now there's another group. It's an unjust, amen, that he still gives mercy to. Why does he give mercy to the unjust? Well, they were just like us not too long ago. And what it is as long he gives them enough, amen, so he can get his hands on them. But every time he goes to them and they refuse, guess what happened? They miss it that day, but somebody else comes around and gives it to them again. Why? Because the unjust, amen, needs the same grace and the same mercy as you and I do. Amen. The mercy of God keeps us, I said, not only from getting what we deserve, but it keeps us to the time where we can hear his voice and come on back to him. Amen. But when a man is blessed of God, when a man has the favor of God, that's totally different than having mercy. Amen. Blessed, when you're blessed, and some people say in highly favor, but when you're blessed of God, whatsoever you do shall prosper. When God is on your side, he's greater than the world is against you. When God is fighting for you, in fact, Israel's enemies found out when God was fighting for them. I remember that army, and every time the fellow would hold his hand up, amen, Israel would win. And every time his hand would go down, the Moabites would win. And so they had the prophet's hand up. Why? Because every time God was trying to do something for them, amen, they had to see the hand of God, and God had favor on them. Just like in your life, as long as you're working and doing what God has you to do and what God wants you to do, guess what? The favor of God continues to move on you. You wonder why you get a good report when you go to the doctor. That's because God is blessing you. Amen. You wonder how things come out in your favor when they should not come out in your favor. It's because God is blessing you. Blessed is that man. Amen. And when I say that man, I'm talking about that particular person. Whenever you're walking with God, and whenever God is walking with you and communing with you, you are blessed.
Yes.
Amen. Mercy keeps it keeps us, and it holds us in a position. But blessed is favor and looking out for its process. Amen. Whenever you're blessed, whatever process that God tells you to use, when you use it, guess what? Things seem to work out in your favor. The second part of that verse, and that's what I want to deal with, it says that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. Let me tell you something. Familiarity breeds contentment. Amen. And must never become true of any portion of God's word. God's word is filled with important instructions, promises, warnings that are vital to the spiritual warfare of every believer. That's why you got to read the Word of God. There's some promises in the Word of God that are activated when you do what God tells you to do. He says, and I'm going to give you one of them that we all know, and that is to bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there might be meat in my house. And he said, look here, if you ever wondering whether my word is true, you do what I tell you to do, and the promises of God is yea and amen. He said, look, not only will I pour you out a blessing that is so big, he said, you won't be able to handle it, you won't be able to hold it, and he said, I'm going to pour it out of a window.
Yeah.
He said, I'm going to pour it out of a window and not a door. I'm going to pour it out of a window and not a garage door, because the little bit I give you, you won't be able to handle it yourself. Have I got a witness? But the promises of God and the instructions of God and the warnings of God is left in his word, and it's valuable and it's vital to us as we go through our spiritual warfare of every believer. Saved folk have no business spending too much time with unsaved people, especially when it comes to getting advice, when it comes to getting counsel. You have no reason to go to somebody else when it comes to getting counsel about God. Amen. That's why Albertina Walker left the song, said, makes no difference what the problem, I can go to God in prayer. Why? Because he's that type of God. My relationship with God is such that whatever I need, whatever I want, whatever I'm trying to do, all I've got to do is seek God and see what God wants to do. And whenever God gives you the instruction, I don't care how silly or crazy it sounds, if you do what God tells you to do, he will activate the promises that go along with what he said. Have I got a witness? A bad apple, let me tell you, a bad apple is just called a bad apple. Amen. You can't take a bad apple, thank you, Brother Jay. You can't take a bad apple and put it in with some good apples. Why? Because it'll spoil the whole bunch. Amen. And y'all agree with that part? You take a bad apple, you put it in with other apples, and they will draw the badness from that apple into the whole bunch. But let me show you something on the flip side. And on the flip side is, but you don't take a bad apple, and you take a good apple and stick it in with a bunch of rotten apples and think that good apple is going to draw something that's going to cause those bad apples to become good again. Amen. In other words, when you're out with these crowds of people that you should not really be associated with, guess what? They draw from you. They take from you, and you end up just as worse off as they are. You know somebody who have an issue with drinking, and they go around people who are always drinking. Guess what? You may not drink the first day, you may not drink the second day, but if you keep on hanging with those people, guess what? You're going to develop a taste for alcohol again. Have I got a witness? Amen. So you got to stay away from folk and stay away from counsel of people who don't mean you no good. If they're not following God and you following God, I'm telling you, you got to cut them off. You don't have to quit talking to them, but you got to cut them loose. You got to let them go. Why? Because everything is a draw and a pull type situation. Even in your relationships, there's a draw and a pull. So, you know, sometimes you have to go do something that they want to do because they're always doing something that you want to do. You trying to be in church and they trying to be in the world. That's a draw and a pull that goes on. And God is trying to work you and get you to where he wants you to be, but you still got one foot over here and one foot over here. When it comes to godly counsel, you got to cut some people off that are not going the same way you're going. Have I got a witness? That's why they say the married people are not hanging out with unmarried people, because it'll draw you back out into the streets. That's why they say you shouldn't put some good stuff with some bad. You don't mix some good product with some bad product. Why? Because the bad product will draw from the good product and not make it better. It'll just make it worse. Amen? Have I got a witness?
Yeah.
First thing you got to do is get rid of bad or ungodly folks that are drawing you back to where you came from. Amen. The second thing, ungodly, a person who does not seek God or seek the will of God and totally ignores the world is gradually, is actually an ungodly person. I don't care how good they are. Let me tell you, I did a homeborn of a woman once, and I kept trying to get people to tell me whether she had ever accepted Christ. And all they kept telling me was that she was a good person. She was a good person. She fed the sick, and she gave money, and she, you know, fed the homeless, and let some people come live with her. But I said, but did she ever accept Christ? And they said, well, she was a good person. preaching on. And so they wanted me to go and preach her into heaven on goodness. And I said, listen here, unless she's accepted Christ, she was good for nothing. Amen. She was good for nothing because she's going to hell just like the rest of them. Amen. But because I don't care how good you are, unless you follow the plan of God, you're just being good for nothing. I used to tell my friends, we spent all of our young adulthood in church, and then we got grown. We left the church like it was nothing. Amen. Amen. But the problem is that you spent all the time you could have been out in the street serving God, and now that you're old enough to know better, now you're out in the street trying to catch up with the stuff that you left. Amen. You got to let that stuff go if you're talking about following God. Amen. It's a blessing to have friends who walk in the Word of God and encourage others to walk in that way. That's why, you know, I love Reverend King, because Reverend, every time I call him, we go on adventures. We may talk about some other stuff and each other, but every now and then we're going to get back to the Word of God. He'll call me on a Monday and start talking about Bible study on Wednesday. Why? Not only is he helping me in terms of that, but he's keeping my mind centered around God. Amen. If I haven't read the lesson, the first thing I got to say to him is, wait, bro, I ain't read the lesson yet. But you know what happens? I go read the lesson, because on Tuesday, he's going to call me again. He's going to say, look, man, I found this in the Word, and I'm still procrastinating about getting it done. So what he does is he keeps me sharp in terms of reading the Word of God. Amen? He keeps me sharp, making sure that whatever we're going to teach, that I at least have looked at, or even when he teaches, he makes sure that happens. I love that brother for that, because we can be talking. He'll talk to me about his message, and we'll go on and on about his message, or my message. He'll say, look, man, I think you ought to look over here, and I think you ought to do this. But he's keeping me sharp, and he's also keeping my mind centered on God. Amen. I love when you come in, Brother James, and you all fired up about Bible study, and you asking questions. You know, normally, you know, we go to Bible study and some fool is in there asking some crazy questions that you know he ain't read the lesson. You know what I mean? But to have somebody come in and you're already on fire with the Word, I have to get in the fire with you. Amen. Andre come in talking, I was talking about a scripture all weekend. I had a song on my mind all weekend. You listen, and you can't help but get in with him because he comes in already on fire. And people come when you got godly men in your life. It causes you to be centered on God. Amen. I go to them brothers for counsel because I know what's in their heart. Amen. Well, 1C says, now standeth in the way of sinners, usually a person who has not been on evil, will not go around those he or she knows is always getting in trouble. They avoid them like the plague. The way of sinners is those who communicate in full blasphemy. You know, one of the things I've gotten away from is people who are always cussing. Always, every time, everything they say, they always cuss. Let me tell you, I don't cuss, I learned a long time ago. You know, if you cuss in front of your kids, one day they'll get you out of the street and start cussing right in front of everybody. So, you know, one of my kids was like that, and she cussed a little bit too. She was better than me. At one point, I had to say, look here, I got to change the way I talk because I can't whoop her because she's getting it from me. Amen? And so I changed the way I talk. But now I can't stand to be around people, and every word is F this and F that, because it bothers my spirit. Amen? My spirit does not feel it when they're cussing and going on around me. And when you're in the way of sinners, you got to accept a whole lot of stuff that you normally would not have to accept. Amen? When you're in church, or when you're in a Bible study, or when you're a godly man, you don't have to worry about people telling some old crazy off-the-wall jokes and talking crazy and acting a fool. But we put ourselves in the way of sinners. Amen? We put ourselves out there. Amen? The way of sinners is those who communicate, as I said, in blasphemy. Happy is the person who avoids those that are inclined to cause trouble or cause an experience. Now, I'm going to tell y'all something. When we were young, Andre Brewington always caused trouble. He always got in all kind of stuff. Man, we would be at the hospital visiting somebody, he ended up getting arrested by the security guard. You know, he just everywhere, just devious type stuff. Now, I'm so glad he's saved, because we can laugh about that stuff now. But you got to stop dealing with people who are taking you the wrong way. Every time you see them, they talking about going to jail, getting a number, talking about going to do this, and that's standing in the way of sinners. Amen. That's getting in the way. God don't want us there. But now listen, there are exceptions to this, my brothers and sisters, if the Lord calls us to specifically go to someone to win them for Christ, then we are not going to receive counsel, but to give them counsel. We're not going to receive something from them, but we're going to deposit something in their spirit, amen, that God has sent us to do. And so that's all right to go, but our motive is to turn someone else away from ungodliness. We begin to mature in Christ if we get to the place where we are giving good counsel to someone who really needs it. Good counsel is, my brother, you need to seek Christ about that. My brother, do you have a prayer life, an active prayer life? Have you received the Lord Jesus as your personal Savior? All the things that you need to be telling the people who come around you that are not saved. When you get around me now, and you know what? We may start off talking about football, but I'm going to sneak in something about Christ. I'm going to talk about what he's done. I'm going to talk about how he's done and how he's lifted me from the place that they're in. Amen. You've got to begin to speak Christ to those people who are outside of the ark of safety. Instead of being in the way of sinners, you've got to change that situation and make it be in the way of the Holy Spirit. Every time you meet somebody and then they don't have Christ, you ought to be trying to push your story on them and how God changed your life. Oh, I got a witness. You ought to be trying to tell people what God has done for you, because the greatest story that can ever be told is the story that you tell about your testimony. Why? Because when you tell people about what God has done for you, you tell it with conviction. You tell it from the heart. You tell it with feeling, and they can't help but feeling what you are saying. My brothers and sisters, last thing on that one is you got to stay away from sinners and the way of sinners. Last one, and I'm gonna sit down because it's almost game time. It says, no, sit in the seat of the scornful. Sit in the seat of the scornful. Now, I was kind of perplexed on this myself, because I said, what do they mean by sitting in the seat of the scornful? Those who sit around scorning usually are those who are idle, with nothing better to do. We see them sitting instead of standing. They're sitting around always complaining about their life, always complaining about their relationship, always complaining about their job. They're scorned, and they want the world to be a part of it. Scorn, folks want company, amen. They want somebody who can say to them, yeah, you've been hurt, but guess what? It's all right. They don't even, if you start telling them that God can lift up a vow down here, they don't want to hear that. They just want somebody to have a pity party with them. Now, this is a picture of how trouble sometimes starts sitting around with critics and backbiters. Amen. It's one of the most unfruitful things that we can do. We need to get out of it and into a useful activity. Instead of sitting around talking about what I don't have and what I wish I could do, we need to start actively trying to do some stuff on our own. It's easy to sit around and talk about not having a job, but guess what? There are jobs everywhere out there if you really want to work, amen? If you really want to do something, but folks will sit around and always talk about what they can't do or what they don't have. I remember the man who was at the pool of Bethesda, and while he was there, that every time he said, look here, I need somebody to put me in the pool. But I'm going to tell you, once you get a taste of Jesus Christ, if I got to crawl, if I got to bite, if I got to wiggle, if it's in the pool, guess what? I want to get in the pool. Wherever God is, that's where I want to be. Instead of complaining about what you don't have, you ought to sit down and come up with a plan on how to get to where you're trying to go. Instead of always doubting and sitting around talking about everybody else, you ought to start talking about what God has done for you. You'd be surprised when you really think about it. God has done some miraculous things for us. Guess what? We're almost 365 days from when God has woke us up. He's always woke us up on time, and he's always woke us up in our right strength and in our right mind. Have I got a witness? He's always come. The sun has always rose 365 days, and it's went down in the evening. Amen. It rained when he told it to rain, and it stopped when he told it to stop. Amen. You never missed a meal, and if you did, it's because you did not want to eat. But God has always supplied for us what we have. So when you stop and think about the little things that God do, guess what you breathe every day? The air is sufficient every day. Amen.
Yeah.
But we don't think about those because we're too busy trying to get the mansion on the hill or trying to get a Lamborghini in the driveway instead of thanking God for the small things. Because guess what? When you thank God for the small things, and when he can trust you for the small things, and he know that he can trust you with the bigger things. That's like a man who said, look here, if I win the lottery, I'm going to give the church some money. And I say, look, if you ain't gave the church no money, but before you won the lottery, what makes you think you're going to give the church some money after you win the lottery? That's a lot of money. That's a whole lot of money. If you pay tithes with that, you'd be mad at yourself. Amen? Scornful. Scornful. Mockery. And evil speaking will rob us of our happiness. A wise person will stay away from people who has wasted their time in this manner. Have you ever seen a complainer, a scorner, or a mocker that was happy? You always come in on the tail end of that complaining. Amen. But those that stay away from these three things, the Bible says, is happy. They're blessed and they're persuaded that God is all that they need. Psalms 1 and 2 says, but when you do what God told you to do, and when you've given God your all, it says that God will bless you. It says, look here, my brothers and sisters, your delight, your love, and everything about you is in the law or the word of the Lord. In the word. Amen. You can have riches and you can have money and you can have fine cars and big houses, but guess what? If I got Jesus, that's enough for me. Rufus used to sing that song that says, if I got Jesus, guess what? That's enough for me. Why? Because my delight or my happiness is in the Lord. In other words, when God is blessing you, there's a happiness and a delight that goes along with God. Amen.
Yes.
And so his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. If you really love something and delight in it and talk about it, it's because it gives you such pleasure to talk about. You make much of it. You exalt it. When God is our deepest pleasure, we display him in our highest treasure. That is why the pursuit of joy is not an optional, because the pursuit of God's glory is not optional. Amen. Whenever you delight in the Lord, the glory of God is always in you. And whenever the glory of God is in you, joy will spring up in your life. Have I got a witness? You talk about glory in it. You hope in it. You pray in it. You have joy in it. You even shout in it. It gives all you have to it. Why? Because when you delight in the Lord, you love him with all of your heart, your mind, and your soul. When you are shown up blessed, verse 3 says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters, and his branches bear fruit in his season. Amen. And his leaf shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. My brothers and sisters, as I get ready to take my seat, whenever you delight in God, everything seems to come into play. Your joy comes into play when you delight in God. Your help comes to play when you delight in God. Everything about you comes into play when you delight in God. He's my hope and he's my joy. He's my all in all. Why? Because I delight in the Lord. Wherever I go and whatever I do, I delight in the Lord. When you see me coming, you know that I delight in the Lord. Why? Because it shines upon my face that I love Jesus more today than I did on yesterday. Is there anybody in here today who can say that they have a delight in the Lord? And whatever they do shall prosper. Why? Because I love the Lord and I love his word. And when you love his word, you'll do his word. And if his word tells you whatever to do in instruction, you're going to do that. Why? Because I love him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
When I love him, when I do what he says, I'm blessed.
Blessed.
Pringle said, I'm blessed. I'm blessed. I am blessed. And he goes on to name stuff. He said, I got shelter, I got clothing, I got help and strength, because I'm blessed. And he's going, here's the part that gets me. At the end of the song, it says, I don't deserve it. Yet.
Sometimes there are turns you want to take, but the way gets hard to
change.
Now you're wondering what you do.